Hello again, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure you're glad to know that we're finally on the home straight of today's marathon. And I hope you had an enjoyable short break and are suitably replenished for our final flourish. This is going to be in two parts. We're going to first have a discussion about geopolitics, followed by a short panel session looking at implementing some of those ideas from the geopolitical discussion into alternative asset allocation. For the first part, I'd like to welcome a man who was the most senior British soldier for many years, serving in Northern Ireland during the Troubles before being deployed to the Gulf War, where he served in the SAS, followed by Bosnia and Kosovo, before commanding forces in both Iraq and Afghanistan. He is the former head of the British Army and the youngest for more than a century to hold this esteemed position, also the longest serving chief of staff since the Second World War. He's also served as director of military strategy, overseeing the UK's response to Russia's invasion of Crimea and military support of Ukraine. His work has merited numerous awards, including the MBE, OBE, CBE, and a knighthood. It's a great honor for me, ladies and gentlemen, to introduce to you General Sir Mark Carleton-Smith. You were drafted in as an army officer general, later to rise to head of the British Army at the height of the Cold War. Are we now living through the early stages of a new Cold War?
Well, Yuri, good afternoon, and hello to you all. I mean, I think we all recognize that we're living through a new era. It doesn't take the German Chancellor to term the phrase Zeitenwende. I was fortunate enough about 35 years ago to be taught by Henry Kissinger, and shortly before he died, he described this particular crease in history that was not going to be for him, but was going to be for my generation, our generation, and our children, as this totally new era. I think it would be optimistic to say that this looks like a new Cold War. Long as it lasted, essentially that was a single strategic undertaking against a monolithic Soviet threat, and of course, one that was successfully concluded, and without the requirement for the confrontation to break out into conflict. If that were to be the case, not only in Europe, but more widely, over the next 10 to 15 years, then I think we can count ourselves as fortunate. I think there are a number of, it's certainly a strategic inflection point. For me, it's probably the third of my adult life and certainly my professional career. The first was Europe's 9/11. The 9th of November 1989, with the collapse and fall of the Berlin Wall, which led to the demise of the former Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact. The second was America's 9/11. Which led to the ill-fated and, you know, calamitous interventions into both Iraq and Afghanistan. And I think the third was the 22nd of February, 22, with the invasion of Ukraine. And what it has done is reminded us all that the rules-based international system that has shaped the international contours in the post-war world, that is neither self-sustaining nor self-organizing. The rules-based international system is actually underpinned by power. It's underpinned by hard power, predominantly, albeit not exclusively, American hard power. And of course, today, unlike the Cold War, the United States and Pax Americana, that it offers us all, finds itself stretched by, in three opposing directions, by three authoritarian states, Russia, Iran, and China, each seeking their own independent sphere of influence separate to any American-backed global order, which, of course, they would claim is simply code for Western hegemony. And we sit here this afternoon, the same period as, of course, President Putin has arrived on a state visit in Beijing. Famously, of course, Kissinger took Nixon in 72 to Beijing in order to break the Soviet-Sino axis, and in so doing, isolated the Soviet Union for successful economic defeat in the Cold War. I think, of course, here, you know, as Europeans and sitting on the continent, we may yet already be at the high water mark of globalization. We're certainly witnessing some of the truncation and rollback of its more constructive and progressive elements. We seem to be living in a world that's increasingly bifurcated, hinged predominantly around China, with the strategic condition being one of strategic unpredictability and volatility. And of course, that manifests itself nowhere more dramatically than here in Eastern Europe, with the most intense and destructive war in the continent since the Second World War, fought between Europe's two largest countries, at a scale and intensity that I think has surprised us all. And it's been a strategic miscalculation, I think, on everybody's behalf. It's been clearly a failure in deterrence, because this one we probably saw coming. It wasn't a surprise, because it fitted a pattern of Putin's behavior that you can track clearly back to his incursion into Georgia in 2008, interventions in Syria and Libya, and across sub-Saharan Africa. And finally, I think it's a moment of reckoning for us all. It's certainly a requiem for that post-Soviet peace, the Cold War, and the conclusion of it that you spoke to. And I think if that were not enough, and just taken at that level, that's an exceptional challenge for our international statecraft and our political leadership, to integrate the national instruments of power, diplomatic, economic, and military, and harness them in support of this single, sustained, long-term geostrategic challenge, is something that I think will be probably the most significant challenge for this particular political generation. And that is further complicated because superimposed on that, I think, are three wider macro geostrategic trends that you will have reflected on yourselves and conceivably even discussed here earlier this morning. And that's the redistribution of global power and its diffusion, predominantly flowing from west to east, with Asia-Pacific destined to become the economic powerhouse by the middle of the century. The second is the growth of systemic competition in all our lives, the notion of great power rivalry and balance of power once more the currency of strategic exchange. And then the permanent and escalating effects of the technological revolution, which isn't just going to accessorize our lives, in many respects it's going to fundamentally transform it. And you heard some of that this afternoon, the integration and combination of artificial intelligence with quantum science and robotics. And I think you could go as far as to say that we're also living through an age of data imperialism, where the main players aren't countries, they're not even governments, they're actually private companies and hyper-empowered individuals. And there's no law of nature that suggests that they should either be good or even benign actors in that space. So I think taken together, a Cold War would be a good result. I think we're in for a much more volatile, unpredictable, and bumpy ride than that.
You were at the hub of the military decision-making process back in 2014, when the little green men emerged in Crimea, General, when Angela Merkel and Barack Obama recommended that there should be no military Western or Ukrainian response to the Russian invasion of Crimea. Was that just because they were constrained by lack of resource?
No, I think, I mean, you know, resource is one of those inputs that clearly influences the range of policy choices that politicians play with. But I think we self-limited and self-censored in the extent that we didn't want what we were inclined to believe was a local, tactical, opportunistic initiative by Putin to escalate into something really very much more substantial. NATO would not have enjoyed standing itself up onto a war footing in 2014, very close to having exhausted its strategic inventory in Afghanistan. We didn't think necessarily that Ukraine's long-term security necessarily represented vital strategic national interest to each of NATO's contributing powers. The United States itself was distracted, and we were probably complacent. And we didn't necessarily believe that this was the opening gambit in what would become a forcible attempted annexation of a major country in Eastern Europe and an attempt to secure by force a Russian buffer zone in the middle of the continent. There was a degree of complacency that, of course, had characterized our response to a series of Russian incursions with respect to poisoning operations, certainly in the United Kingdom. We were confronting a range of near-permanent cyber attacks across our critical national infrastructure. And we assumed that Putin had taken a different set of lessons from the experience of our interventions in Iraq and Afghanistan. The big headline, which seemed to be, don't do it. Wars are very much easier to start than they are to win. And warfare has a logic all of its own that becomes very difficult to control. And it seemed that he developed a hybrid playbook, which meant that he would exploit his advantages tactically below the threshold of conflict. And that was something that major European policymakers assumed was the price of peace in Europe in the second and third decades of the 21st century, which of course proved a flawed assumption.
This hybrid approach to warfare, will this become the new normal? We've seen the use of drones to wipe out energy facilities in Ukraine and military facilities in Iran by the Israelis, but we've also seen tragic wholesale urban destruction with Mariupol in Ukraine and most of Gaza reduced to rubble. This hybrid approach between the high tech and the First and Second World War approach, is this now the new normal of warfare?
Well, the spectrum of conflict, you know, continues to proliferate and now encompasses, you know, wider, more novel domains. I think 10 years ago, people assumed that warfare was going to become very surgical, the military equivalent of keyhole surgery, and that the answer to these problems was not massed boots on the ground with all the attendant political, presentational, and legitimacy considerations surrounding it, let alone the cost. But you could manage this with drones, with a degree of connecting tissue, conceivably with special forces, surrogates, and proxies on the ground. And that, of course, was how the CIA very successfully prosecuted the counter-Al-Qaeda operation in Waziristan and the tribal areas of Western Pakistan. And that seemed to be the lesson. Certainly, the Conservative government in the UK, David Cameron's government, felt that they wouldn't seek to repeat an experience of Iraq and Afghanistan, but they would take that light touch model, and that would become the house style of warfare of the future. We didn't need large, expensive standing armies. We needed specialists, much greater investment in cyber and space capabilities, and autonomous systems. And that proved a very successful recipe to the challenge of countering the ISIS caliphate in northern Iraq and northern Syria. And for a while, that seemed to be the successful model for future warfare. That's, of course, today being turned on its head, because we see that warfare is not just progressive, the ubiquity of drones, the battlefield as one giant sensor, the increasing lethality, range, and precision of modern weapon systems, let alone the virulence and the velocity. And the ability to bring existential threats to bear at net speed, almost anonymously, with all the problems of attribution, which challenges policymakers, therefore, in terms of their rapid responses. And today, I think you'll see this combination particularly playing out in Ukraine. Very high, sophisticated thresholds of the military utility of artificial intelligence, the harnessing daily of hundreds of thousands of intelligence data points, resolving them down to very precise coordinates on the ground that are then struck by long-range precision missiles. The complete ubiquity of drone warfare at ever-extended ranges, but that matched with the grinding attritional nature of static defensive positions, men dug in 15 feet underground, being shelled by in the region of 6 to 15,000 artillery shells a day, the sort of consumption rate that one associated with the First World War.
We've heard about documents, General, which Ukrainian military intelligence have seen, and perhaps you've been party to these documents, about Russia's plans for occupied territories. Do you think Putin really believes he can obliterate more cities like Mariupol, ethnically cleanse them, move Russians in, Ukrainians out, and rebuild them as part of a new Russia, which he's talking about?
Well, I think he does believe it. Whether he's right or not, you know, clearly the jury on that is out. And the extent to which Ukraine is going to be able to sustain this war is sadly not strictly in their gift. And the $61 billion worth of military aid voted through by the US Congress last month. I mean, I would say that alone is certainly not a recipe for victory. It's actually hardly even today a recipe for survival. So we are in a very long-term, very attritional and destructive conflict. And you need to remember that these sorts of confrontations, armies win battles, but nation-states and economies actually win wars. And Putin, of course, is gearing up for a long-sustained industrial campaign, confident that he can sustain it longer than the West can be bothered to tolerate the costs. We're already bored of it. It's costing us a lot of money. It's complicating our politics. We're beginning to wonder whether, frankly, Ukraine can win the war, and on that basis, aren't we simply just sustaining an unwinnable conflict at increasing cost in human life? And really, this needs to come to a political solution, which really, writ large, means a partition of Ukraine, which is very easy for Western politicians to articulate, but very much more difficult for Ukrainians to live with, given that they have very direct experience of what it's now like to live beside a belligerent Russia and a Putin that no one can trust. To your question as to whether Putin, does he think he can continue to destroy Ukraine's eastern cities? Absolutely he can. He's got the wherewithal. His military industrial complex is now manning triple shifts. He can sustain the manpower bill in the way that Ukraine today is struggling. The average age of the Ukrainian soldier on the front line is in his early 40s. Let me tell you, you don't win wars with middle-aged men, but they're trying to protect the flower of their youth, for very obvious reasons. And there is a manpower problem in Ukraine. And unsurprisingly, they, in the third year of this very direct confrontation, they're absolutely exhausted. And their ability to sustain this level of effort is going to require not just the same from us, but even more in the future. And I think irrespective of which country you come from, you might be skeptical as the degree of commitment that you think the international community can continue to sustain.
So, General, from what you're saying, this could be a wake-up call to the Europeans, certainly to the EU. If we have 20 million plus more migrants on the move after more serious bombardment of Ukraine and Gaza as well, against the backdrop of a UK government arguing for 5 years about moving 100 refugees to Rwanda. I mean, we could actually see the disintegration of the EU and the euro with the amount of migrants potentially that we might see on the move into Europe. This could make serious dents into the potential stability of checking who these people are, where they're coming from, what sort of effect they will have on the economies of Europe.
Well, I do think Europe in the balance of the last decade, has absorbed only the tip of the human iceberg that sits particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, where if the demographic indices are in any way accurate, suggests that the population will more than double to 2.5 billion in the next 20 years or so. And those young people will track north, and they'll come out through the cockpit of North Africa, the southern Mediterranean littoral increasingly controlled today by authoritarian states under the sway of both Moscow and Beijing. And it's not inconceivable that the immigration tap can simply be switched on and switched off to suit those authoritarian regimes and to challenge, of course, you know, the relative polarity of European politics. And we've all lived through the consequences. You know, populism and nationalism are not yet exhausted political forces, even in Europe. And if we are confronted by another generation of displaced people and immigrants, particularly from the broader Middle East and Africa, then I think we can expect more of this extreme political polarization, which, of course, makes it very much more difficult to keep the sinews and fabric of federal institutions such as the EU and NATO coherent.
The crisis, potential crisis you're describing, which we're sleepwalking into, I think the potential solution that you suggested earlier, if we look back into history, when Nixon and Kissinger helped to disrupt that Sino-Soviet axis, that has to be the answer to this. It has to come from rapprochement with China. Is that very much your feeling?
Well, China is the major strategic challenge, particularly for the United States. I mean, notwithstanding almost everything I've said, almost all the conversations I have in Washington are about China, China, China. And we Europeans have become very used to the United States as a transatlantic nation. We're going to have to become used to the fact that in the 21st century, the United States is going to predominantly be a Pacific nation. And of course, American soldiers were in the Philippines and in Sumatra long before they were ever in Normandy or in the Middle East. They would, on that basis, invite us Europeans to do very much more for ourselves with respect to our energy and defense and security in Europe. And irrespective of whoever wins the American presidential election, I think that's going to be a demand that they make of us, which will become more expensive. And they'll also be interested in the extent to which we can continue to contribute to their ability to grow a range of regional alliances and partnerships across the Indo-Asia Pacific to manage a much more assertive and belligerent China. I mean, in President Xi, I mean, think of him as Mao with an iPhone, the most influential and authoritative Chinese leader, now in his 11th, if not 12th year in power, self-appointed effectively for life. He's been very clear in his publicly stated ambition that China, under his watch, will be the preeminent global power by the middle of the century, underpinned by the world's single largest economy, fueled by the gravitational pull of the world's largest single consumer market and domestic consumption, a prize too big to contain and too big for us to ignore, but controlled by the world's single most successful Communist Party, with a very effective strategy of economic colonization, financial coercion, and military modernization. And I think a very clear sense of their historical destiny and the inexorable rise of China matched by the terminal structural decline of the West. And they may yet be proven right. It's fortunate for us that, of course, the Chinese economic miracle is confronting very significant headwinds. It's clearly not a permanent state of affairs. And as they begin to wrestle with that, with the growing politicization of their economy and the associated stifling effects, they're drifting from market principles to the much more comfortable approach of state control and state direction. And I think certainly in the wake of the pandemic, we can see that closed systems are probably much less resilient and adaptive than open ones, and their COVID-19 performance was hardly a sort of triumph in crisis management. They're spending over $200 billion a year to manage their own range of societal paradoxes and internal security issues. So China is watching events in Europe and the broader Middle East very carefully. Interesting that Xi, of course, has just swung through Paris, Belgrade, and Budapest. The war in Europe gives him an opportunity to act as an honest broker, he would claim, in Europe. He's playing the same playbook in the Middle East at the moment. If there is a danger with China, it's a strategic miscalculation. It's clearly not in either Beijing or Washington's interests to fight a war. But they might put themselves in a position where they do fall into the Thucydides trap. And to avoid that, there needs to be a very coherent, structured, strategic dialogue with sufficient tolerance to agree to disagree in those areas where our values are very distinct, but also to agree to act in unison in those areas where we do have a common interest. And it's not beyond the pale to say that, you know, China does have a natural interest in scoping out a set of rules of the road that are appropriate for countries such as China in the 21st century. It's not entirely illegitimate to claim that the rules-based international system was a victor's law, and it was a victor's law, you know, framed 80 years ago or so, and it probably these international fora are ripe now for revision.
You talked, General, about the military-industrial complex in Russia and about the fueling of that, and similarly, the military has some influence in China as well in terms of industrial production there. There are other countries in Pakistan, in Turkey, in parts of Southeast Asia where the military is, in fact, the only institution really trusted, with governments regularly being deposed in military coups. Do you expect military institutions to be taking an increasing role in the administration of many countries?
God, I'd hope not. And so should you. I mean, those countries that you mention, the military has a very prominent presence. But those are also countries where the military is feared by the population, which is a terrible strategic position to live through. I mean, where I come from and the army that I represented, we needed the army to be a trusted element of the fabric of the nation, and our license to operate was entirely incumbent on the relevance, the competence, and the integrity of the organization, and the relationships that the senior leadership had with the political leadership of the day. And as an institution, we had to, in a sense, ensure that we were able to contribute to a much wider range of strategic national resilience issues, because certainly in the light of the global pandemic, most countries woke up to the sense that their security was much more than the aggregate of missiles, tanks, and drones. It was much more fundamentally geared around their confidence of the availability of clean and sustainable energy, assured access to pharmaceuticals, the digital integrity of our 5G networks, our ability to reshore some of our more sensitive supply chains and being more pragmatic about strategic stockpiling. And the degree to which the armed forces could contribute to resilience in the round, I think, is going to be the litmus test for the degree to which hard-pressed governments in the future are going to be able to continue to invest in the armed forces against a much wider range of resilience and security issues.
The geopolitical disruption and the situations of armed conflict you're vividly describing, General, they produce a multitude of investment opportunities. Firstly, clean energy, rebuilding infrastructure in battlefields such as Ukraine and Gaza. Secondly, investing in dual-use technology, peacetime technology which can be converted for drone warfare, for radio signal interception, etc. Do you expect fund managers and the investment community, the type of people we have in this room, to become more and more involved in these post and within conflict opportunities for investment?
I mean, I do think there's an obligation for the financial community to get over, you know, many of their concerns, most of them sort of couched in the relative priority that ESG has enjoyed, and recognize that FDI and reconstruction in the round, certainly in Ukraine, eventually, and at some juncture, one hopes, in Gaza, is going to be fundamental to stabilizing those regions. It's difficult to see the climate emerging yet. I mean, there are probably three key fundamentals that need to underpin it, particularly in Israel today. I mean, the issues are, firstly, security. Secondly, the governance for Gaza. And only then, when people are confident that that has been worked through, I think will good scarce resource begin to flow. And I think in both Ukraine and in Israel today, there's a lack of political vision for how the war ends. For rather obvious reasons, I think, in Ukraine, because Zelensky and his government is not in the position of being able to trust a bogus peace with Putin. And a rather different set of criteria for Netanyahu's government in Tel Aviv. But without that political vision, then of course you don't attract investment. And without investment, you don't get the reconstruction that's absolutely essential.
Is there a question for the general from the audience? The gentleman in the front row, the microphone is just coming to you. Another question here, a few hands going up. I'm sure there's plenty of questions here. So the microphone should be on the way to you, to the gentleman in the front row here. Firstly, excellent. Very, very good. And if you can please state your name and company first.
Sahel Jaffer from Genesis Consulting. Thank you very much, General, for an insightful and fascinating account of this geopolitics and everything else. One card we haven't touched upon is North Korea, which is completely out of control right now and positioned itself to be an international arms supplier, given the opportunities it has right now. And number two, you have not actually touched upon the issue of Taiwan and what it could actually bring in terms of the Chinese aspirations of finally taking over Taiwan.
Excellent. Well, I do think we'd be having a much more serious conversation about North Korea if its significance and relative priority had not been eclipsed by the war in Ukraine and subsequently overshadowed by the Gaza incursion. So North Korea remains a very difficult fly in the ointment. It's clear that Beijing's influence over Pyongyang is not quite as firm as we had assumed. The degree to which the regime is rational is, of course, difficult to determine. But I think rather in the manner that the mullahs in Tehran find it more convenient to retain their nuclear program marginally short of weaponization, and that gives them greater diplomatic leverage. I think Pyongyang will also sense that whilst they might posture and threaten to actually demonstrate that they have a viable nuclear warhead that they can fit to a ballistic missile with the range to hit American cities on the West Coast, would overnight change their position. And if they weren't, you know, enjoying isolated pariah status as it was, they then would find themselves in a very much more difficult position. It does play into the calculus around Taiwan. I personally think that Beijing will be cautious about playing with fire with respect to Taiwan. There are very significant lessons that they are learning from the Russian experience in Ukraine. I touched on them briefly, but I mean, warfare does have a logic of its own. I also think a war with Taiwan inevitably throws them into a military confrontation with the United States and their allies. And that scenario is not in Beijing's interest, and it's very difficult to determine that they would win. And it also flies in the face of a couple of Chinese strategic precepts, which for them, of course, the acme of skill is to win without fighting. So they will threaten Taiwan, and they will leave more forcible military options on the table, but I think that's to threaten. The second strategic precept is that they regard warfare as the most significant issue of state, never and not to be undertaken lightly, because if they do so, and they take the risk, and they lose the war, they run the risk of not only losing the party, but also the state. So I think this plays long. I think it's a major concern for the United States, clearly, because if China is able to embrace Taiwan in whatever manner they're able to over a generation or two, it makes America's ability to underwrite global trade in the South China Sea and the Taiwan Straits and to influence the Western Pacific really very much more difficult and puts their regional allies, think Japan, South Korea and the Philippines, in a very much more difficult position. And those regional players, big ones, Indonesia, Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore, they will have to bend very much more dramatically to Beijing's will in the manner that the Central Asian states have had to with respect to Russia.
Thank you for your excellent question. We have another question there in the fourth row there. You've got a microphone.
Yeah, thank you, Yuri. Brian Blanchard with AllianceBernstein. So my venerable peer asked about the Taiwan question. So let me pivot back to Europe. So noted your comments on whichever American administration wins the elections. You know, there's an expectation that Europe will, you know, pull up its boots and look to provide its own security. So two-part question. Given that President Macron...
Just one question, please, because we've got another question to come.
So let's talk about then Ukraine. Could you see a political solution in which Ukraine is partitioned in some way, shape, or form, as determined by the West over whatever period of time that may be, where Ukraine ends up, whatever's left of it, ends up in NATO? And do you think that is a solution that holds water? Thank you.
Well, I can see a political compromise that does lead to a partition. And the degree to which the Western element of that partition is either a heavily, protected NATO protectorate under, you know, NATO's trusteeship is not inconceivable. Whether it will enjoy full NATO membership and status is very much more difficult to determine, particularly if it's still subject to, you know, a frozen conflict. But NATO players won't want to take that off the table. And when NATO convenes in the United States in the summer, it will want to have an active conversation around how to integrate Ukraine in the future, noting that if it's not prepared to underwrite
Ukraine's security. It almost certainly prolongs the war, because Putin will believe that the international community, and the United States particularly, remains ambivalent about its support, not just to Ukraine, but actually to NATO itself. And all he needs to do is press harder and press longer, which of course is his strategy.
And of course, with Odessa as the seaport, the access to the Black Sea, absolutely vital to that solution.
Well, that too, and 40% of Ukraine's energy infrastructure has either been destroyed now or is occupied by Russian forces. And so part of this strategy, of course, is to destroy the Ukrainian economy, amongst other things.
And one more quick question here from the front. I'm afraid this will have to be the last question.
Sure, thank you. Bill Jones, Bowman Covenants. Can you touch upon the potentially destabilizing impact of cyber warfare and terrorism?
I think when I look back to our response to the particular circumstances of 9/11 and compare them to the state-based geostrategic challenges that we face today, I think we hyperventilated and overemphasized the nature of international terrorism. It's not going to go away, but nor is it coherent. In fact, it's strategically illiterate to try and wage war on what's no more than either a proper noun or a tactic. So we do need to live with this steady backdrop of extremism, and occasionally that breaks out into very violent terrorist acts. But in the scheme of things, that is small fry. Of course, it becomes more dramatic when international terrorist organizations are able to equip themselves with existential capabilities. And one of the effects of the technological revolution is to democratize warfare and to flatten the ability and to enable terrorist organizations and other wider non-state actors to actually conceivably accrue weapons of mass destruction. And to be fair to the then Bush government, that, of course, really was the catalyst for the global war on terror. There was the dramatic nature of the events of 9/11, sure, and they had to respond. But it was the very clear threat that these international terrorist organizations were going to get weapons of mass destruction, and that is what the intelligence seemed to suggest. So, I mean, your answer is right. We can talk about Russia, Iran, China, North Korea, but there is also the second-order issue of international terrorism.
Well, I know that we could carry on these questions all afternoon, and I know that I have to apologize to all of you because I saw many other hands going up, and hopefully we can carry on this conversation at the cocktails after the event is finished today. But I think all of you will remember today how privileged we've been to listen to the wisdom of the general and to be part of his strategic decision-making process and insight, which I think the asset management industry can also benefit very greatly from. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for General Sir Mark Carleton-Smith.
Thank you very much. No.